Studio Robota presenta. Perdidos en el éter. Nuestros intrépidos héroes siguen surcando las dimensiones en pos de la justicia.
¡Sí! Una dimensión donde Tesla todavía está vivo.
No solo eso, sino que también es un héroe mundial.
El bien.
Listo, Andriago, los prisioneros están asegurados.
Macho, esta zona fantasma es ideal para contener a los fatales, Montarrojos y otros delincuentes son nuevos para siempre.
Y la verdad.
Sí, era cierto. Estos documentos secretos del Pentágono lo prueban.
George Lucas creó los midichlorians porque perdió la apuesta con Spielberg.
Buscando el bienestar de la humanidad, viajan a remotos mundos paralelos, persiguiendo tesoros artísticos de incomparable valor.
En este kiosco de Tierra 245 tienen ejemplares del número 1 de Action Comics.
¡Y a solo un dólar! ¿Cómo dice, señor kiosquero? ¿Cómo que porque nuestro billete tiene a Washington y no a John Brown?
Así, armados de sus prodigiosos intelectos y corpulentas figuras, surcan el espacio interdimensional, enfrentándose a las fuerzas del mal y defendiendo a los inocentes. Los villanos los buscan para vengarse, pero nuestros héroes ya se encuentran a salvo, porque están perdidos en el éter.
Un espacio dedicado a la difusión de la historieta, la ciencia ficción, los juegos de rol y temas afines, tales como la protección de la humanidad y la defensa del multiverso, porque ser extraño tiene su ciencia.
El programa número 198 de Perdidos en el Éter.
Wow.
Pensé que ibas a hacer la rima.
Volvimos para atrás.
198, ¿por qué para atrás? El anterior fue 197.
Ah, 17,
y este es el 198. Pensé que me ibas a hacer la rima. Nos encontramos acá degustando una cerveza artesanal canadiense, Quebecois, de Quebec, para hacerlo preciso, que se llama Gros Mollet.
Tobillo grueso.
¿No? Tobillo gordo, sí, grueso. Cerveza marrón fuerte, la Strong Brown Ale, Bière Brun Fort.
Una delicia, la verdad.
Sí, riquísima. De la Microbrasserie du Lac Saint-Jean. Yo hablo muy mal el francés porque no tengo práctica, pero creo que mi pronunciación anda bastante bien. Es una de las que me trajo mi amigo Philippe. Acá dice, en la ciudad la historia de Gros Mollet está, se encuentra entre los souvenirs. Es la imagen de nuestra cerveza marrón que se impone su presencia rotunda en la boca con sus acentos de maltas acarameladas.
No sé, yo lo que te puedo decir es que tiene una etiqueta un leñador, lo cual lo hace muy canadiense, porque si no es un jugador de hockey, digo.
O ambas cosas. Estamos acá en Perdidos en el Éter, mi nombre es Magnus y tengo por acá el señor Andriao, el profesor dinosaurio jugando a tablet y computadora cerca. Y les recordamos que radioether.tk es nuestra página, facebook.com/radioether y twitter.com/perdidoseter. Está en el mail también y en Google Plus, pero no lo usa nadie. Y nos encuentran en un montón de plataformas diferentes para escucharlos. ¿Por qué estamos tomando una cerveza canadiense? Además de porque nos place y de porque Alá sabe que no somos perfectos.
Qué genial que estuvo tu amigo hacerte la dedicatoria.
Bueno, pero que la hizo de casualidad. Contemos algo. Estuvo de visita, como habrán escuchado en programas anteriores, Philippe Girard, historietista franco-canadiense que yo tuve el placer de conocer y volverme amigo luego por Facebook. Lo conocí en Estocolmo hace un par de años cuando estuve. Y bueno, hubo onda, ¿no? Philippe es un historietista que tiene.
¿Hubo onda?
No de esa.
Munecia, hubo onda.
¿Por qué le dices a Munecia?
Ella sabe.
¿Por lo de los padres,
sí,
y de su rasquera?
Claro.
Historias para otro día. Y de repente dar un piagupa de alguien.
Oh, no.
Philippe es un historietista que lleva casi 20 años trabajando profesionalmente de eso, desde el 97 a esta parte. Tiene 20 libros editados en su provincia de Quebec, su Canadá. Tres de ellos traducidos al inglés. Es el primer historietista canadiense en ser traducido al ruso. Es el primero en publicar en Uruguay. No sé si es tan importante. Ganó premios importantes con nombres en francés que no puedo recordar. Y es ganador como mejor historietista en francés de los premios Joe Shuster, el premio más importante del cómic canadiense. Philippe ha hecho tiras, trabajó para la revista Spirou en Bélgica, nada más y nada menos, y ha estado publicado en un montón de cosas diferentes y ahora en Gas 3K. Otra cosa que yo puedo decir
llegó.
Otra cosa que yo puedo decir orgullosamente es que Philippe siempre ha dibujado sus propios guiones, porque es lo que llaman un cartoonist, un autor completo de los americanos, pero a la hora de escribir el guion de otra persona, me invitó a mí a escribir para él. Y participé en un libro editado en Quebec sobre qué hubiese pasado si ganaba el sí en el referéndum de independencia del 95. Y hemos charlado de escribir alguna otra cosa nueva también. Philippe quería venir a Uruguay, colaboró con un par de historias, y mandamos una carta junto con Matías Castro Montego Comics invitándole al festival, como le dicen ellos, a las convenciones. Y él presentó eso al Consejo de las Artes de Canadá. Pero este aquí que demoraba 2 meses en contestar. Philip dijo, yo me mando igual y si después me reintegran la plata, genial. La diferencia de ser historietista es el primer mundo. Vamos, Philip no es que anda en Ferrari y todo lo demás, vive bien de eso, pero labura muchísimo, ¿verdad? Pero bueno, laburar allá puede laburar de verdad. Philip vino, quedó encantado con Montevideo.
Comió un asadito acá, ¿no?
Comió un asado acá en casa, sí. Estaba más encantado con el proceso del fuego y lo demás que con el asado mismo, pero le gustó, se comió un chivito también, no canadiense. Pero viste, vos viste que cuando viene alguien de visita te va a decir que la ciudad es linda, pero yo podía notar que el loco de verdad estaba entusiasmado con el lugar. Que era el tamaño correcto, porque él es de Quebec, que es una ciudad pequeña en la provincia, a pesar de que le da el nombre. Montreal es la ciudad gigante. Philippe entiende mucho de lo que pasamos los uruguayos estando al lado de gigantes como Argentina y Brasil. Primero porque Canadá está al lado de Estados Unidos, que tiene mucha más gente, a pesar de que Canadá tenga más terreno. Y al mismo tiempo, Philippe es de la minoría francoparlante de Canadá. 60 millones de personas habitan Canadá, solo 7 hablan francés.
Sí,
Philippe, las hijas, la mamá, el papá y la novia. Philippe, de hecho, no aprendió a hablar inglés hasta los 12 años. Entonces entendía cómo es la dinámica de Uruguay. Quedó fascinado con Motivo Comics. Te decía el programa pasado, lo comparó con Angoulême. Creo que es un poquito mucho.
Exageró un poquito.
Pero tiene razón. Motivo Comics, para el tamaño de este país, es una convención grande. Fueron 7.000 personas este año.
Vos tenés más números que yo. Los vi
en el diario.
Pregunté y todavía no tenían una idea clara y no me dijeron.
Los vi en el diario, pero sé que en años anteriores han sido 5.000, 6.000 y andan en la vuelta. Pero ya que vayan miles de personas, sacás un montón de gente. Y bueno, y Philippe colaboró con dos historias para la Gas 3K. Colaboró con una historia muda llamada Putin sobre una comida tradicional de su país que se pudo deleitar la gente en la charla que se dio en el Maple Leaf Bistro, un restaurante uruguayo canadiense, o sea, de uruguayos que vivieron en Canadá. Y una que había presentado por un concurso en Dinamarca, pero no quedó, se lo presentó nosotros entonces, que era una historia inspirada en Hamlet, pero con lucha mexicana.
Muy interesante.
Lo divertido del asunto es que estaba en inglés la historia, yo la traduje al español, pero yo no podía traducir como se me cantaban las cosas. Tenía que usar el vocabulario de traducciones de Hamlet. No me quedé con una sola. Cuando me servía más una, usé más una que la otra. Criterio mío, capaz que es malo. Y vamos a hacer más cosas con Philippe. Y la verdad que además es un tipo, vos como decías el año pasado, pudiste charlar poco con él. Pero es un tipo extremadamente cálido y gran persona para estar. Fan de David Bowie. Así que eso es...
Como Sanchis.
Como Sanchis también. Y a pesar de que sus cómics van por otro lado, también fan de los superhéroes y del Doctor Who y otras cosas. Philippe escribe mucha cosa autobiográfica, mucha cosa. Sus libros favoritos en este momento son dos que ha sacado y está aprendiendo más, que se llaman La Gran Noxé, La Gran Oscuridad se llama el primero, no recuerdo el nombre del otro. Resulta que una de sus abuelas, materna en este caso, escribió todos los días durante 5 años en la década del 30 y del 40 en su diario. Algo impensado para una mujer de la época y que te da una visión a cómo vivía la gente
el día a día.
El día a día, y más una mujer que no suelen tener voz hasta épocas recientes, ¿verdad? Pero también es un tipo capaz de escribir cosas con humor. Roots and Ghoulies, el libro que escribió, que está traducido al ruso, son sobre 9 días de peripecias en Rusia junto a su editor. Vimos que tomarse Hamlet con lucha. También, y un tipo muy interesante. Philip dio dos charlas acá. Una en el Maple Leaf, como dijimos, que no quedaron grabadas íntegras por problemas técnicos, pero las aprovechamos porque valen la pena. La del Maple Leaf yo pregunté, y lo van a escuchar, pregunté si alguien que estaba presente no manejaba inglés, si no hubiese traducido, y como todo el mundo dijo que se las manejaba, bueno, fue todo en inglés porque si no iba a ir y volver más complicado. La charla, los fragmentos que hay más cortos, sí, de la charla que dio el Instituto José de Paivaneto, el trabajo de mi esposa con niños de contexto crítico escolares en este caso, sí, yo traduje todo al español, obviamente. Y la idea en esa... Fueron dos públicos distintos. Uno fue a oír hablar a un historietista y el otro fueron a escuchar hablar escritores, porque era en la Semana del Libro, por los 200 años de la Biblioteca Nacional. Sí, no, excelente.
Aplausos.
Y Philip dijo, si solo uno de esos niños sale escritor, esta charla valió la pena. Y yo digo, si solo uno se anima a leer más, cuando vienen de familias donde general no se lee, vale también. De hecho, esa charla no estaba planificada. Me la planteó mi señora en representación de su jefa, y además de ella, que es como la subdirectora, mi señora ahí en el instituto. Y en cuanto le dije a Philip se subió al carro, no solo a una charla en ese lugar, sino además que permitió que lo sacara de los circuitos turísticos de la ciudad. Pues yo lo llevé a la Ciudad Vieja, lo llevé al centro, lo llevé al Prado, pero acá fue un lugar, una zona que no es normal, y dijo, estuvo bueno estar en contacto con gente de verdad, no con los fans que van a la convención, que también estuvo barro. Pobre Philip, le presenté a 48.000 personas en la convención. Y vos sabés cómo es que caminemos vos o yo por un tío cómics. Sí, nos paran a saludarnos porque nos conocemos de años. Y bueno, no hay mucho más que decir, escuchen.
Bueno, lo que falta decir es lo que empezamos a hablar.
Perdón.
Todo sí. Esto empezó por la explicación de por qué te hice la dedicatoria que te hice en la etapa de...
Ah, perdón, sí, porque yo le conté una historia a Philip. Porque estábamos hablando de la comida y las dietas y de cómo yo, como yo estaba paseando por ahí, no iba a comprar una ensaladita, detrás comprar un asado. Y recordé un personaje del libro Extranjero en Tierra Extraña, uno de nuestros libros favoritos, mío y de Andrago, de Robert Heinlein, en donde hay un personaje que es un doctor musulmán, el doctor Mahmud, que cada vez que le ofrecen alcohol, contesta, Alá sabe que no soy perfecto. No debería, pero Alá sabe que no
soy perfecto. Dale, servime, Alá sabe que no soy perfecto.
Y desde entonces, Andrago y yo hemos utilizado esa frase cuando nos ofrecemos alcohol, a pesar de que ninguno de los dos es musulmán, por ningún decreto. Le conté esta historia a Philip y le encantó. Y entonces, mientras estaban dibujando él y Tybox las clásicas tapas a mano de la Gas3K, que suelen mostrar personajes que aparecen adentro de la revista, Philip en una dibujó a Mickey y le puso un globito que decía en inglés, Alá sabe que no soy perfecto. Me la quedé yo esa revista, porque la verdad me pareció que valía la pena. Y acá estamos degustando un par de cervezas, porque cuando Philip me dijo, ¿qué te traigo de Canadá? Yo dije cerveza, como corresponde. Y lo vamos a dejar escuchando esos dos fragmentos de charla. Y este programa, como no podía ser de otra manera, va a estar compuesto musicalmente hablando por música quebecua, música de la provincia.
Vas a poner Rush, supongo.
No, Philip no me dejó, odia Rush.
Philip acaba de perder un poco de puntos conmigo.
Yo iba a poner Rush porque es la primera banda canadiense en la que pienso y porque vos, pero Philip no me dejó. Entre los fragmentos de la charla separando van a escuchar un poco del himno no oficial de Quebec, Jean du País, la gente de la tierra del país. Pero ahora vamos a arrancar con Jean Leloup, que es un músico que me recomendó, que es una especie medio como de folk mezclado con rap. Juan el Lobo se llama.
Sí.
Haciendo voyageur, viajero. Y para finalizar, van a escuchar que Philip habla durante la charla del Maple Leaf sobre un cómic suyo que se llama Pasión Rougemont, el hombre Pasión Roja, porque lo inspiró en un cantante romántico quebecois meloso que se llama Mario, debe ser Mario, ¿no? Mario
Pelchet.
Cuando y cuá. Cuando nosotros creemos, creo que se traduce eso, que la verdad es como escuchar a Luis Miguel francés, pero bueno.
Peor todavía.
Es un Luis Miguel francés. Vamos a escuchar entonces a Jean Leloup haciendo Voyager y los fragmentos de
Charles. Ustedes Philip. Perfectamente pueden sacar esta parte, poner Rush.
¿Sabes? Sí. Pero bueno, Philippe va a mostrar esto por ahí y no quería que se escuchara Rush. Ya seguimos.
Perdidos en el éter.
Ta solitude de voyageur, pauvre guerrier sans peur. Dans la gare de nulle part, tu attends ton prochain départ. Où elle n'y sera pas, celle que tu cherches et qui n'existe pas, et qui n'existe pas. Nous étions heureux, tous les deux, disaient les amoureux. Et toujours le temps passe. Qu'est-ce que tu veux qu'on fasse? C'est la mort qui grimace. C'est la mort qui grimace. Sombre est ta solitude de voyageur, pauvre guerrier sans peur. À travers la vitre embuée, tu vois le paysage qui défile. Les poteaux de téléphone et les fils, et enfin les champs de blé qui te prennent à rêver, qui te prennent à rêver. Te rappelles-tu la table en fleurs, ta mère et tes sœurs, ton père et son déshonneur. Sombre est ta solitude de voyageur, comme tu pleures, pauvre déserteur. Et soudain tu sens la douleur, et soudain tu sens ton cœur. Ne te reste plus que quelques heures, voyageur. Bientôt tu meurs. Bientôt tu meurs. Après-demain comme avant-hier, tout retourne à la poussière. Et ne subsiste que le destin de tes passages dans les trains, de ton visage et du sien, de tes pas sur les chemins. Dors tranquille, ce n'est rien, juste un voyage, juste un peu plus loin. Nous étions heureux, tous les deux, disaient les amoureux. Et toujours le temps passe, qu'est-ce que tu veux qu'on fasse? Tu vois la mort en face, c'est la vie qui grimace. Et toujours le temps passe, quoi, quoi, corbeau qui passe dans les ailes, dis-moi où sont les hirondelles. Tu vois la mort en face, quoi, corbeau qui passe dans les ailes, dis-moi où sont les hirondelles. Nous étions quoi, corbeau qui passe dans les ailes, moi où sont les hirondelles. Quoi, quoi, corbeau qui passe dans les ailes, moi où sont les hirondelles. Nous et toujours les étions.
Who draws comics in here? Who's a cartoonist? All right.
That guy at the back.
Right.
Yeah, you will meet more over the weekend.
Yeah, I guess. I hope so. Certainly hope so.
You will probably meet everybody in this country that makes comics over the weekend because there's not that much of us. We have a saying. There's few of us and we know each other.
It's the same everywhere. It's a small community, that's for sure.
Bueno, muchas gracias. ¿Alguien no habla inglés? Como para... Si en algún momento vamos a ir en inglés... Debemos traer por lo menos... Si en algún momento alguien tiene alguna duda específica, traducimos. Pero I was just asking if anybody had a problem with English. Okay, everybody, thank you for coming. It's a weekday, so it's not easy. And thank you to Daniel and his family for hosting us here at the Bistro, really beautiful place. You should eat the food, it's good. and of course, thank you to Philippe for being here. It's a real honor to have him here. It's I was writing the editorial for a magazine where Philippe has two stories on this one. And we've had people from all over the world, Sweden, we got Canada now. We have a Malaysian artist writing a drawing for us this time. But this is the first time that somebody, not from Argentina, because next time, somebody from the other side of the world, because it's the other side of the world.
It is.
Comes over for the lunch, and it's really, really an honor. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Thanks for inviting me, actually. I was anxious to come. I was so thrilled
It's a great pleasure for me to be here.
I met Philippe 2 years ago in Sweden, in Stockholm. Really great festival, really great place.
Absolutely, absolutely.
And a bunch of Canadians, because the Stockholm International Serietiket Festival, I think I said it right.
Serietiket?
Serietiket is the library.
Oh, yeah.
Because Serien is comic.
Yes, you're right.
They have a featured country every year, and that year was Canada. So there was like 1,500 Canadians in the delegation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, quite a lot, actually.
And to be honest, I only knew two of the people there. I knew Seth. Mm-hmm. And of course, I knew Katie Beaton. I love her work. And I ended up being in the same catalog and poster with Katie. That's amazing. But then there was Dakota and you and other people. And it was like there's all the whole world of Canadian comics that we don't get here at all. The same way they don't get us. Not because of the language, because everything can be translated. And most people here interested in comics can read a little bit of English at least. But because we don't get it, we don't know it, and to be able to get have your eyes opened to that reality, to different ways of making comics, and different stories to tell, and in the end, the same stories because we're all people. But even if we've got different circumstances, it was great, and being able to bring some of that stuff over to the readers, that is, I think that's great, and also Philippe invited me. Was it last year or this? Was it last year?
Last fall.
To write a script for him. Mm-hmm. He draws and writes. And you haven't, you didn't have. You
no, it's the only story I ever drew that someone else wrote for me.
Yeah, so it's really an honor.
So you're my only scenarist, my only writer so far.
And I had to, and it was a book about the Quebec independence referendum in 95. And I was like, what am I going to write about that? I was, but you're older than me and you were in Canada. I was 15 in Montevideo. Internet wasn't a thing. I mean, I used the web, but not right now. You didn't have news all the time coming to the world. What am I going to do? I figured it out. We're going to translate it into Spanish at some point so people can read it.
I hope so.
But it was really great. Philip had to draw Montevideo. Would it ever be any?
It was my condition, actually, because I had nothing to say about the referendum itself. So I said, write a story. There's only one condition. I want to draw Montevideo. So first panel, actually.
Yeah, so now I'm going to get him to draw more Montevideo.
Yeah, no problem.
and yeah, it was that 2 years ago, we started a nice friendship.
Yeah, exactly. Actually, we sat in a restaurant,
yes.
one close to one to another, and that's how it all started. I heard him speaking Spanish. And I turned around and said, hey, where are you from? And
I don't know why I was speaking in Spanish, because nobody there spoke Spanish.
No, I know. That's why it was so
because
strange.
Because my host, Gonzalo, her name escaped me now, his wife, she works at the UN embassy. They weren't there. Everybody there was Swedish or Canadian. What else are you doing speaking Spanish? Probably telling people how to say something in Spanish.
I think you were talking about Uruguay, actually. That's the thing, you know. He's quite an ambassador for Uruguay, you know.
Most people here know me, and they know I talk a lot. Shut up, you especially. Shut up. But yeah, of course, there's a lot of nice stuff to say about Uruguay. We complain all the time, but where people don't understand that people complain everywhere.
Well, no, I can't say that people complain here that much. Frankly.
Oh no, you should look at my Facebook friend status and everything, and mine as well. I complain all the time, but I mostly complain in Spanish about the stuff from here. But okay, Philippe. Philippe, you was born in 1971.
Yeah, I'm an old guy.
Quebec City.
Yeah, exactly.
It's Quebec.
Quebec.
Quebec. My mm-hmm. French is really rusty, but I try. and even I write it like they write it in French. But I try to respect the names. And you started making comics in 97? Well, professionally.
Professionally, exactly, yes, in 97. With a bunch of friends, we started a fanzine. It was called Tabasco. You know what that is? It's a spicy sauce. And so that's how it all started for us. First issue was like 100 copies, and we sold them in a month. And we sold it like $1, which is really cheap, actually. So second edition was 200 copies, same thing. We sold them. It was sold out in a month. And then we went to 300 and 400 and 500 I think the last number we made was number 22, and it was 1,000 copies. And it sold out again. So then, that was approximately 96 or 95. In 97, professional publishers began to make offers to us to publish comic books and pay us to do it. Because, you know, there's an American saying that goes like, if you're good at something, don't do it for free. That's what you have to remember here today.
We're trying.
Yeah. So that's all. Yeah. So in 97, I started drawing and writing my own comics professionally.
But let's go back. When did you start drawing and making comics?
For fun?
For fun.
You know, I remember being a small kid, like 5 or 6 years old, and then my brother was collecting hockey cards, and I was using them to make the
panels.
Yeah, to draw the panels on my comics. So, yeah, that's how it all began for me. Yeah.
Because I've had the luck to interview a lot of artists, most of them Uruguayan, and usually the pattern is people stop drawing at a certain age. But most artists don't.
Yeah,
they keep
absolutely.
Going. Was it like that for you?
Absolutely, absolutely. I've been drawing all my life. I had to slow down last year because I had a tennis elbow, but I still drew a 90-page comics, even though I suffered a lot.
And you still drew the strip?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And I draw a weekly strip for the CBC, Canadian Broadcasting Corporation, for their website. Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Hockey cards. You can get panels.
Yeah, exactly. So these are worth a lot of money.
Actually, they're worth a little bit of money, I'm guessing. Yeah.
So for those of you who can't see it, this is what a hockey card looks like.
I have a lot of them, but they're superheroes.
It's the same.
I also have football cards, like soccer cards.
If you're in there, I will give you my son.
Good luck, he's in Spain.
So we used to go to the convenience store.
And you fight.
We used to go to the convenience store and buy a small pack of hockey cards with... In the old days, it would cost approximately a quarter for a pack of four or five hockey cards. And I use them to draw the panels of my comics.
With the bubblegum.
Yeah,
did it come with bubblegum at that time?
True, with the bubblegum. Yeah, that's right.
Closest thing we had here was in the 94 Football Cup. You used to have actually like albums with cards that you paste into them.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Okay. But then in 94, they started selling football cards, like that's one, but full of players. But they came when you bought like little pastries, alfajores. Eran por de suelo, no? Yeah, you would actually like buy three of them and get one pack. But then there was a black market for the cards and everything. It was a real craze. But what about your family? Your family ever did something related with art or
absolutely not. My father was selling medication, and my mother was working as a receptionist for a religious community. And you know, my I have two brothers. One is a comedian, and the other one is a mathematician. And
nice.
Now I'm the only illustrator, or cartoonist, whatever you call it, in the family. And I remember my parents were really scared when I was young. And when I told them I want to be a cartoonist, my dad said, "Oh my God, can't you be at least a knife thrower in a circus? There'd be at least one job for you." You know, back in those days, it was crazy, especially when you come from the French community like me, because we're a fairly small amount of people, 7 million, and Quebecers don't read
two
much.
Euro wise. Yeah, but how many people are there total in Canada? A lot.
35 million.
35
million.
It's about 10% of the U.S.
Plus. Plus, you have all the Americans, the English-speaking Americans. So publishing in English is a wiser move, you know, if you look at it as a business move. But, you know, when you were raised in Quebec in 1970-something like I was, we read Asterix and Tintin and, you know, so we all wanted to publish in French. But it's still very, very difficult. Most of my friends have quit because, you know, they don't get paid much and... Of course, the Frenchmen, they're not waiting for us, you know. There's a great deal of extremely talented cartoonists in France and Belgium and Switzerland, you know, so it's still a tough game. But anyways.
You know, here, whenever you tell people you work in comics or you're an artist, they say, "Oh, but what do you do for work?"
Yeah, for a living.
And the lucky few that actually work doing that, they don't just draw comics. They work in advertising,
yeah,
or movies or whatever.
That's what I did when I started. You know, in 97, I was still making a bit of graphic design. And, you know, once in a while, a couple of illustrations, you know, for magazines and newspapers. I don't do that much anymore. You know, it has to be something that I really want to do. And like a month ago, I drew a poster for a comics festival in Russia. obviously that was like really fantastic, so I did it. But out from that, now I concentrate on my comics.
Well, among other things, Philippe is the only Canadian cartoonist translated into Russian. And I think we can safely say you're the only one publishing Uruguay right now.
Thanks to you.
And you've drawn for a lot of publications. He drew for La Presse in Montreal.
Exactly.
And for the Spirou magazine in Belgium, which is one of the things I read when I was a kid. Mm-hmm. I tried to read them because my brother lived in France and he had a lot of French comics. And I tried to stir heart of them and understand them, Asterix, Tintin, and Spirou. And I was like, man, I'm publishing somebody who publishes in Spirou.
That's crazy. It's one of the things that I'm really proud of. For 2 years, I made a comic strip of my daughter. She was like 5 years old. And you know what? How kids are when they're so young. They keep saying funny stuff. So I was writing all those funny stuff in a small booklet. And then up to a certain point, I had like 20 or 25 funny stories about her. So I began drawing them just for myself. And then a friend told me, "Hey man, you have to send that to Spirou." So I sent all my cartoons to them, and they said, "All right, we're buying the whole bunch." And yeah,
amazing.
And it's really, as I said, it's really difficult for a French Canadian to publish in France, you know, because we have a love-hate relationship with them. It's not that easy, you know. I'm sure you guys can relate to that.
Yes.
Yeah. So you know, when they come to Quebec, they always say, "Oh yeah, you have a strange accent. How come you don't do things that way? Oh, in France we don't do things that way. Oh, it's cold in here. You know, nothing's good for them." So
it's like getting a basic from your parents, and your apartment is not good enough, and your job is not good enough.
You know, when your mom tells you, "Well, you should get a haircut." You know, that's approximately the same kind of relationship. But you know, still, it's a wider market because you have like 80 million of Frenchmen in France, and I don't know, 30 million in Belgium, and I don't know how many millions in Switzerland and Luxembourg. So overall, it's a lot more people than in Quebec, and most of all, they read, which we don't in Quebec. So it's still, you know, it's a goal for a lot of people, a lot of, I would say French-Canadian cartoonists, but it's really difficult.
Let's go back to when you started with the fanzine with Tabasco. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. What kind of stories did you tell then, and how much did the kind of stories you tell today have changed from that?
I drew a character. Can I make a drawing on something just to show you how it looks? You know, that's a funny story. I had a friend who was jogging close to my apartment, and my brother's a teacher, and he was teaching on the south shore of the city, and he had no car.
That mathematician guy?
No. Yeah, exactly. Him. So he didn't have a car, so he needed a car. So I gave him my car for a year, and I said, "Go ahead, man, use my car." And so one day he called me and said, "You know what? I lost a wheel while I was driving. Oh my God! So I needed to go back home and take the paperwork from the garage and you know, the insurance company and stuff like that." And on my way to my apartment, I met my friend who was jogging, and he said, "You know, Phil, we should start a comic magazine, you and I." And I said, "Okay, let's talk about that in a couple of days. You know, today I'm kind of busy. I have stuff that I have to take care of." So a couple of days later, he called me, and we went for a beer, and we talked about it. So we had only one serious concept, and instead of folding our sheet of paper like this, we decided that we would fold it on the opposite side, and that is called a Slim Jim. That format. So that's what my dad told me. I said, "Oh my God, Slim Jim, that's a good name for a character." So my first comic character, I'm going to go through right now, that was his name, Slim Jim, or in French, Jim le Malin. So he was really, really thin, and he was prisoner of the panel. So let's see, he looked like this. So all of the panels were vertical, and he didn't have much space to move. So instead, he would transform or morph into something else, a mushroom, celery, whatever, Modigliani painting, a Picasso painting, stuff like that. So that was my first comic character, the one that I drew for Tabasco.
Funny enough, that concept reminds me of some stuff I've seen in Uruguay comics, like in a magazine called Wambia. They would do either political humor or really weird, surreal comics. And it reminds me a little bit of that. People who have read Wambia can maybe can say it's wrong or wrong if it's just an impression of mine.
But you know, sometimes when you get into the business of comics, you have to start. You know, everybody does what they can with what they have. And that's especially true when you start.
Nobody's, you know, you feel like, oh, I need more space, I'm not good enough at drawing, my storytelling isn't good enough. Well, it doesn't matter. Start from, you know, with what you have, try to do something with what you're able to do, and things will grow on and move and go better over the years.
Jean du pays, c'est votre tour.
How is it seeing your books translated? How do you feel? Do you read them afterwards?
No,
I mean, you get say in the translation or making corrections or?
Yes, I. You know, it's a difficult thing, you know, because I can handle a conversation, I can write, you know, a letter, but dialogues in English, that's a different ballgame. So, you know, when the publisher approached me for a translation at first, I said, all right, I'm going to do it. So I sat down and translated the first 10 pages of this book here. And then I looked at it and said, okay, no, it's not working. This is not a novel, you know, it's not... I don't need the Oxford English Dictionary to do this. I need the wording, the phrasing of, you know, different kind of people from different backgrounds. It's so subtle. I mean, you have to be really, really good in English. So, and then I called a friend and he said, you know, when you're translating, normally you should be translating from a language to your own language. So, you know, that's why we both decided that we hire a professional translator to make the translation, just to make sure that the, you know, the feeling of it and the music of it would be like, you know, honest and trustable for an English-speaking person.
But at the same time, they have to keep your voice.
Yes, they do. And of course, it's a problem because normally they learn their French from from France-speaking teacher. It's almost a completely different language. And, well, you know, it's a bit of it's a dialogue, actually. You know, they will send me the pages. I will read them and say, okay, here, there's a problem here. My character is a bum. You know, it's not someone who went through medicine, you know, or you know, art school. It's a bum. So he needs to speak differently. I need someone with a different kind of phrasing. So we discuss the situation, but it's really difficult, you know. Again, you've got two visions, and sometimes they will, you know, clash and eventually create some sort of, you know, situation. But yeah, that's the art of translation, I guess.
Mm-hmm. How about the art supplies and materials that you, what mm-hmm. do you use for drawing usually?
Well, I use, you know, things have been moving on over the years. For the last 15 years, mostly I drew with this pen. It's a brush pen, I guess most of you have seen it, with India ink in it. And then since I developed my tennis elbow, I had to change tools. So I tried this really, really cheap pen. I buy a box of 10 for like 14 Canadian dollars. So it's about, it's a dollar something for each. It's really, really cheap. But the thing is, if I draw a panel or two with it, then there's not, you know, there's not that much ink in the pen. So I have to use a lot of them. Say maybe 200 or 250 for a complete book. But I like the feeling of it. And for a guy who suffered, you know, from tennis elbow, the good thing with these pen is that I can make a drawing without pushing too hard on the tip of the pen. So it's one of the good things that I like.
Do you get bulk discount for them?
No, not really.
At least you should get the brand that makes him to sponsor you or something, like sports people.
And you know, at first, you know, like 5 or 6 years ago, I used to make sketches before inking my panels, which I don't really do anymore. I'm trying to capture as much as possible the first draft of every drawing. So instead, you know, back in the old days, you know, I would like sketch every panel, you know, and decide where the text bubbles would go in the image. And then suddenly that approach didn't fit me anymore. So now I'm drawing on a board or in a booklet like this one. I make a drawing, you know, and it takes all the place that it needs to take. And then I will scan it and I will resize it or only put a part of it on some sort of a mosaic that I'm making in Photoshop. So some parts of the drawing are not used in the final page, but that's the way I need to do it right now.
How about color? Are you using Photoshop for color?
Or? Yeah, I use Photoshop for color, but that's something else. Again, you know, in the past 2 years, I've been playing a lot with this kind of pen. It's a brush, but instead than putting ink in the, you know, in the reservoir here, I put water, and I make some. How do you say that in English? The grayscales.
Yeah,
grayscales. So I might end up doing a book that way. I'm a bit tired of the computer actually. You know, it's kind of it's time consuming, and you know, it's not the part of the job that I like. The fun part is sitting with my cheap pencil and my cheap booklet in my little studio at home and making drawings. You know, playing on the computer isn't that fun anymore, not for me. Mm-hmm.
How about the writing process? Do you write the full script beforehand, or do you go with a general idea to the page and
it depends. You know, it depends. For this book here, Killing Velázquez, since it's an autobiographical story, I knew exactly what I wanted to do. So I sat down and drew everything without a plan. But normally I will write 2 or 3 scenarios per year, and then I will choose the best one and make a book the next year with it. So that's the thing. You know, when you're making comics, there's one book, the one you're drawing, the one you're working on, and you always have to think about the next one. So you, up to a certain point, you will be drawing something and writing something else, just to make sure you keep the wheel.
To keep the wheel going.
Yeah, going in a few months. So yeah, but that's my technique. Yes, eventually, but I'd say that in the last 4 years, I tend to write down my stories.
Mm-hmm. There's something about Killing Velázquez. I mean, I know it's a book that you wrote to tell a story. You don't really like to talk about the story anymore. Something that happened to you.
Yeah, it's
read it, buy it. It's good.
it's the story of the problems I had with a pedophile priest when I was a teenager. So yes, but I didn't do it because I needed to evacuate something or get revenge. Or it's not about vengeance. It's just that I felt like it. It's the kind of book that might help someone, you know, in the future, in a class. I don't know, you know, and books. People don't read, but public libraries buy books, and they stay on the shelves, and you know, sometimes for 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, and sometimes, you know, when you're lucky, a new reader will pick up your book just because he liked the cover and read it, and an old book can change a life. That's what I'm talking about in this book.
Yes.
That's why I did it. You know, I felt like I had a good story to tell, and something I believed, something... It wasn't pointless, you know.
No.
I had something to say, but it's not about vengeance. And I must say one thing now. I guess it's the only book that I've done for which I have this kind of feeling. But I regret doing it now because it hurt lots of people around me. My mother, for instance, who's really, really religious, believed that, you know, when you're a priest, you make your counts with God when you're dead. So she believed it was Well, she didn't like it. Let's just say it that way. And but time will tell if I made the right move, you know. But.
From a story, I mean, you said it's something that might help somebody, and I'm sure it will. In my case, I'm lucky I didn't have any of that issues. I didn't read at that age. But from a writer's and a reader's perspective, it's really a very well-told story. And it's like... Since I'm a writer too, I'm reading a book and it says, why didn't I think of using that before?
Yeah.
There's a nice meta-narrative because you said an old book saves lives and it's about you finding something in old books.
Exactly.
And there's this technique you use that when you jump from a real scene to a scene of the book, the person last speaking in the previous page starts speaking the dialogue mm-hmm. from the book.
Mm-hmm.
At first, I didn't understand what was going on, but it was really—it's really genius.
But and it's the kind of thing that I really like to do, and I admit, I pumped that technique from movies, you know, or even in television. Sometimes you're in a scene, people are say in the kitchen cooking food, and then you hear a car honk. And then the match cuts, and you go to the next scene, and you're down in the street, and let's say a bus driver is behind the wheel, and he's, you know, honking.
Yeah, I've seen that a lot with dialogues in comic, like the dialogue from the next scene starts, but this is like interweaving the fiction within the fiction, which is not actually a fiction.
No.
And I think it really works. I don't know what I was going to say now. You started doing short strips and everything. When did you move into longer, like novel length stories?
It came all naturally, you know. At first, drawing short stories was like a good way for me just to get into the business of doing comics. But you know, after a couple of years, I needed to do more. I felt like I had to do more to feel like I was challenging myself, actually. So it came all naturally. But you see, for the last 2 years, I've been making that comic strip for the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation. And I really, really, really like it, you know. And it's I don't know how to say it. It's, in a way, it's coming back to my roots. But, you know, if I can keep pushing things strong enough, and if I can keep doing it for like 5 or 10 years, eventually it'll make it like a really big book with, you know, something.
It's where I'm getting my Canadian news. And using it to practice my French.
Thank you.
Okay, I don't know if you want to add anything, or if anybody has questions.
Do you have any questions? Yeah.
Sure. I remember back in the 90s, early 90s to late 90s, a lot of the French-Canadian artists that were around were more focused on the short strips, the comedics, the pure comedic strips, the satirical comedy,
yeah,
even. Was it difficult for you to move away from the tendency to stay in that area?
No, because... You know, it's a good question because, you know, since I don't live in Montreal, you know, that's one of the things that I didn't tell you. In Quebec, the main city is Montreal. Half of the population of the province of Quebec lives in Montreal. So since I don't live there, you know, sometimes I feel like I'm not exactly a part of the gang, you know. Most of the cartoonists live in Montreal. So I guess that for them, it would have been a problem, you know, just to move away from what you just described. But since, you know, in Quebec City, we're like 20 cartoonists in the city. 18 of them are making comics for the European publishers. And that's one of the things, you know, that I made clear with my, you know, with the publishers that I work with, even the European ones. I am not interested in telling a story about, you know, French history or, I don't know, Italian history. I mean, that's not my, it's not my fight. I want to tell stuff that happened, you know, somewhere close to me. So it's like I put myself off the track, you know, without anyone helping me. So no, I mean, once I decided that I wanted to make a longer story, I mean, nobody complained about it. Actually, the way I see it, and from the kind of feedback that I receive, I think that readers really appreciate the fact that I moved away from those, you know, comic strips.
Yeah, because Canadian mainstream doesn't really exist.
It does exist with guys like Seth and Chester Brown and Joe Ullman, and even in the French community, you have that guy Michel Rabagliati who draws the Paul series. Maybe you've heard about it. You know, French mainstream does exist, but it's just that for an American, it doesn't exist.
Those are the magazines. They're not assembled yet, but... again, I forgot what I was going to say. Oh, yeah, 20 books later, mm-hmm. I don't think you'd made the wrong choice.
No, I don't think I made the right choice. But the thing is now, after 20 books, I want to make sure that, you know, I when I start a project, I want to make sure that it's the good one, you know? Because among 20 books, some of them, you know, I don't like as much as the others. So today I take time, you know, I try to think about my choices. Sometimes I will take a pause between two projects just to, you know, just to make sure I can clear off my head and, you know, clear the decks, just make sure that, okay, should I really choose this project or the other one? Or ask someone for a scenario like I did with you a few months ago.
And it looks better in French than it did in English. Well, about your books, you like some of them more than others.
This one here.
Okay. Parents will tell you there are no favorite kids. It's a lot.
But it's not the same with books, frankly. This one here, Obituary Man and Killing Velasquez, are obviously two that I really like. And the books that I did with about my grandmother as well, I really like. And, you know, maybe you heard about this, but 4 years ago, there was a riot in Quebec because the government wanted to raise the tuition fees for the people in universities. And, you know, I have a daughter who's 17 now, and I was looking at her, you know, and thinking, you know, in a few years, she'll be the one in university. So I created this superhero here.
whose name is Passion Rouge Man. That's really difficult to translate, but it would be something like Passion Red Man. Because there's a really kitsch singer in Quebec called Mario Pelcha. He only makes love songs. And one of his songs is Red, the Color of Passion. You know.
I am curiously wanting to go look for his music.
Maybe you shouldn't.
Anyways, I like kitsch stuff.
Anyways, so I decided that I would create that non-violent superhero who's like flying over, I would say, the crime scenes or the riot scenes. And... just, you know, criticizing the action of the government, because back then it was a liberal government in Quebec, which was really, really corrupted. And everybody knew they were corrupted, but they were in power because the opposition's goal is to make a separation of Quebec from Canada. So, you know.
It's liberal in the sense of, because there's two meanings of liberal.
It's liberal in no sense at all. It's just, you've got the liberals.
Here liberal is not what it means in the US, for example.
No.
It's the opposite, usually.
It's a bit like that in Quebec, you know. You've got the liberals and you've got the separatists. So the liberals don't want Quebec to separate from Canada, but they're corrupted. Yeah, exactly. So I needed to criticize those guys. So I created this hero, and it went like way beyond my expectations. I got a letter from the prime minister telling me that I was making bad publicity for Quebec.
Success.
Well, actually, people kept telling me, man, you have to keep on pushing on this guy because he's really good. So yeah, that's my special.
Harper, yes, right.
What? No, Charest. Sure. No, I doubt Stephen Harper would.
The Quebecois.
Yeah, yeah. Stephen Harper doesn't read.
He, much less French.
He only has two books in his bookshelves, and he hasn't finished coloring the first one. Luckily, we're not stuck with that bastard anymore.
You'll find out politicians are kind of the same.
Yeah, well, we had a pretty good one in this guy, I can tell you. Other questions?
She's a writer.
Yeah, but you know, it depends.
Now you are.
It depends.
If you write, you're a writer.
If you wrote, you're a writer. It depends on the project. You know, sometimes you kind of carry something, and you know, you need just to let it go, and you know, it'll come all by itself eventually. But you know, my own personal philosophy with stories is that the stories float around us, and a story will decide by itself who it will choose to be told. So then you, as the writer, have to put your ego aside and kind of listen to the ego of the story and let it, you know, let it go all by itself and, you know, take the place it has to take. So it, you know, that's why I'm saying it changes from project to project. But basically, I'm looking for an intuition. That's the main thing, you know. When I say I walk and think about my stories, I'm just trying to, you know, catch a wave or, you know, just get a vibe. And if the vibe is strong enough, I will sit and do it. But, you know, it's all based on intuition, really.
Well, based on, just on a tangent at first, do you ever get any inspiration from other kinds of art forms?
Yes, but not cartoons. That's my thing, you know. It can be architecture, opera, music.
I get stuff from music all the time.
Yeah, but not cartoon. I think it's one of the problems in the cartoon industries. Cartoonists love cartoon so much that cartoon is influencing the art form of cartooning.
Endogamic.
And
you say that
inbreeding.
Inbreeding. Yeah. That's what I would have said.
That's a bit harsher. It happens. Yeah.
Yeah. So eventually, yes, I think the best thing to do is, you know, find something that you like that is not comic and put it into comic. That's the best of perspectives.
I'm stealing from Bowie. Yes, that is correct. Any other questions, Paolo?
Yes.
You mentioned yearning to work for the French-Belgium market at some point, and a Spanish artist came here some years ago, and he mentioned how European artists wanted to work for the North American market.
Yes.
Because they like to have steady work and pay.
Yes.
And, well, the North American artists wanted to work for Europe because it was like this more outdoor thing.
And better deadlines.
Better deadlines, better pay. But the thing is that the European market has been changing and editorials are being a bit more snobbish. And they're not as...
But you know that, actually, no. Though these days, the problem is that the European, well, let's say the French, from France, market of comics is going through a crisis like we've never seen before. The publishers are trying to focus on series that have worked before, even though most of the times the team of writer and illustrator are dead. They will pick people who can make approximately the same thing, and you know, actually they're putting all their money and all their hope and all their, you know, their strategy on these, you know, I don't like the word reruns, but you know, that's how it sounds to me. So the whole market of comics in France is getting through an awful crisis. So lots of people have lost their job. They've cut the paycheck in half. You know, like 2 or 3 years ago, you could have like 20,000 euros to draw a comic book, a 44 pages comic book. Now it's more like 8,000 euros. And you have to give a part to the writer. So, you know...
There's still a lot of money here.
Yeah, you know, but you know, the cost of living... The cost of living in France is so high that, you know, lots of excellent cartoonists have, you know, given up the fight and decided that they would do something else. Teaching, you know, working in a bookstore, because it's too difficult. So can you imagine for the Quebecers like me, like my friends, who used to work for these guys, suddenly they're in front of a dead end, you know?
How's the industry in Canada when it comes to comic book distribution? Mm-hmm. You know, do you have like regular series, monthly series,
yes,
and graphic novels that they open?
Sometimes, but you know, since we're like at the cornerstone, we're in the middle of, you know, the American influence and the European influence. So you have lots of people doing lots of different things and going in lots of diverse directions, you know. So some people will do things the American way with a regular publication every month. Some will prefer to publish an album, you know, a complete book that will come out eventually after a year or a year and a half of work. It depends, really. And as for distribution, it's a big problem because Canada is a wide country. And, you know, from Montreal to Calgary, you have like thousands of kilometers and you don't have people all over the place. You know, sometimes you drive for hundreds of kilometers without seeing anyone. It's the same. It's the same problem for musicians or, a circus. You have to cover a big distance.
And when it comes to format, I'm not familiar with every different publication of your work, so I don't know if you've worked on the large album formats.
I have.
French style.
The French
style. Yeah, yes,
exactly.
I have.
Exactly. Which one do you feel more comfortable with?
Again, it depends on the project. You know, it's always a question. It's always a matter of feeling. In my case, you know, it might be a gamble, okay, but I believe that comics readers are open-minded. 15 years ago, they agreed to let a book like this one enter their bookshelves. Black and white, soft cover. For the French market, that was revolution. Because, you know, in the old days, a comic book had to be like Asterix or Tintin book with a hardcover and colors.
The size.
And exactly the size. If you didn't respect those, you know, those standards, you weren't a cartoonist. You were like an amateur. But suddenly people began to see that there was a really interesting potential, narratively speaking, in the black and white graphic novel industry.
They stopped judging a book by its cover.
That's the way to say it. So that's why I'm, you know, when I think about my story, the first question I will ask myself is it a good story? Second question, do I feel in my gut that I want to make it? And then all the rest, it's not my business. You know, the publisher will take decisions for the format and the standards, and, you know, it's up to him as far as I'm concerned.
We really envy that because everybody here is a self-publisher.
Yeah, but, you know, frankly, you know, ask Americans, Frenchmen, Belgians, you know, guys from Switzerland. The business of comics in the main market and the main industry is going in such a big crisis. Maybe not the superheroes, okay, but all the rest.
Yeah.
That I believe that in, let's say in short term, the business of self-publishing is the future of comics. Yeah, I mean, you have to keep on pushing on self-publishing. This is where you have the greatest area of liberty, and this is where you make the stuff that you want to make, and that's what matters in the end. You know, did you bribe your talent? Did you commit yourself in such an awful, you know, an awful way that when you look at your books 2 or 3 or 4 years, you know, later, you say, oh my God, I shouldn't have done that. You know, and when you publish your own work, generally you don't have to make that kind of choice. You go for the stuff that you like. And I believe that this is the future of comics. Comics is not about, you know, it's like all those comics, you know, teaching comics in school. I'm sorry, but, you know, if you have to go to school, teach video games. Comic is for, you know, it's for rebellion. It's for criticizing stuff. It's for making fun of people. You don't learn that in school.
You do make fun of people's comics.
Yeah, but I mean, you don't. But you know, not. I don't want a teacher to tell me how
I
to do
it. I got made fun
yeah,
of
you get it all by yourself. That's the way it works.
Well, going into the future of comics and self-publishing, what's your views on digital comics?
Well, I'm making one right now for the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation. I'm publishing a comic strip every Thursday for them. And you know, strangely, I have like lots of liberty. I mean, it's almost like I can do whatever I want to do, almost. Okay. And you know, 5 years ago, I would have told you, man, it's not for me. And now that I've been making it for 2 years, it's super fun. I like it. My grandmother can look at it on her computer, and you know, she can enlarge the image if the characters are too small, if the text is too small. I see a lot of, you know, advantages in doing it. But I still hope that somewhere in the end, a book will come out of it.
We do have an attachment to print books. I
exactly,
mean,
in paper.
We started making comics with Feather together in 2009, but we only got printed in 2011. And it's this little, it's not even a magazine, it's a pamphlet. And it was like,
this is where we get our motivation, actually.
It's a physical object.
No, but you're right. I agree with you.
And he's looking at the new magazine, and he's smiling, so I know it was well-printed. Sorry, I'm distracted.
But people who like books really like books, you know. I personally, you know, when I like the novel, I really appreciate the fact that I can touch it in my bookshelves, you know. I still haven't been able to get rid of that, you know, that feeling and that pleasure. I still want it. I believe that, especially in the business of comics, comic readers do like books.
And the nice thing about books is that young people who like to read, whatever few they are, they also like the physical book.
Yeah, exactly.
So there's something there.
And you know, there's never going to be a new operating system for this. You know? It'll never go out of style, you know, it's already out of style. So
I think it's a Monty Python sketch about a guy who goes from scrolls to book and he can't understand them. You've seen him, it's really good. Any other questions?
Have you ever had any problems with restrictions from the business on your formats?
No, I've had projects that have been refused by publishers. You know, that's the pros and cons of comics, but as far as formats are, no, you know. But honestly, you know, I never think about that. And no one's ever offered me a format that didn't fit my vision of the book. I think, frankly, all the people who work in the business of books, you know, they're an artisan, a craftsman, is that it?
Artista, the artist, yeah.
You know?
An artisan.
Exactly. So those folks, they like books so much that they want to make an object of beauty out of it. So, you know, if you make 5 panels per page, it won't make a nice book if you publish it that small. You know, it has to be big. People will sense it, and the publisher will sense it when he sees your page. So, no, I never think about that stuff, really.
Lucky man.
But
okay, anything else?
Do you do publishing for both CBC in English and in French?
No, so far it's in French. But, Yeah, Radio Canada, but they're talking about translating it. It's just that it makes it, it's like another constraint for me, because you know if the gag is based on the words in French, it might not work in English.
And it's also based on Quebecois reality.
On Quebec City news, yeah. But that's something that could be like, it's a circle that could be widened easily, but you know, they have to discuss it. But of course, you know, I'd love it. Do I need to say it? I'd love it, yeah.
So how would you feel writing directly in English?
It's not a problem. You know, that wrestling story I sent you?
Yes.
I wrote it in English and... No, it's not a problem. It's a problem when you wrote your story in French first, and then you decide to translate it. That's a problem.
Yeah.
But if you sit and write the story at first in English, well, in my case, it's not a problem. No.
Any other questions? All right, thank you very much.
Well, thanks to
everybody.
I still have books in front. Yes. If you want to look at them and go through them or buy them.
I've read these two and I can tell you they're really good. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure this one is too.
Thanks for being here.
Thank you. And I don't know if we're going to have... Fede, there isn't going to be... You can get a copy of the new one. There's two Philippe stories there.
Yeah.
And one of them, I didn't even have to read letter because it was silent. Thank you.
My pleasure.
Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot.
Merci beaucoup.
Merci.
Jean du pays, c'est votre tour.
Vive de hacer eso Philippe y le permite viajar por todo el mundo porque ahora está acá en Uruguay, pero Philippe ha estado en Rusia, en Cuba, Dinamarca,
Sweden, France.
Nos conocimos en Suecia con Philippe hace 2 años, que yo tuve también la suerte de viajar.
Jean du pays, c'est votre tour.
Because you like it and because people will read them and it will make your friends laugh. You can, you know, you become the center of attention in the group.
Dice que cuando tenés historias para compartir, tenés que escribirlas, compartirlas con tus amigos, les podés hacer reír, los podés entretener, y podés volverte como el centro de atención si es lo que te gusta.
And when I was your age, I thought that a good story could only take place in London, Paris, or New York. But as I grew older, I understood that you could tell a good story from your own neighborhood. It doesn't have to be a very big city or a very known city.
Dice que cuando era chico se pensaba que, como era lo que se ve en televisión en otros lados, que una buena historia solo puede pasar en Nueva York o en Londres o en otros países. Y después se dio cuenta que una buena historia puede pasar en tu barrio. De hecho, yo he leído uno de los libros de Philippe que cuenta cosas de cuando tenía 11, 12 años de su barrio en la ciudad de Quebec, que bueno, es un lugar muy distinto a Montevideo, pero al mismo tiempo ves que hay gente yendo a la escuela, subiéndose a los ómnibus, trabajando, y te das cuenta que la gente, que tenemos muchas cosas parecidas. Ustedes tienen a Francisco, que es un profesor, que es de otro país, y seguro que hay cosas muy distintas, y con Janella estudia música, que es de Cuba, y hay muchas cosas, pero también hay muchas cosas iguales, y es muy divertido encontrar qué hay de parecido en otros lados, y seguro que si a vos te gusta escribir, ¿hay alguna historia de tu barrio? I'm adding some stuff to your... Seguro que hay algo que puedas contar que a otros les va a interesar. Vamos en orden, estabas tú después.
Jean du pays, c'est votre tour.
Dice Philippe que él solo va a usar una imagen de internet si tiene que dibujar un edificio en particular, como la Estatua de la Libertad o la Torre Eiffel. De hecho, el año pasado Philippe dibujó una historia que escribí yo que pasaba en Montevideo. Philippe no había estado todavía en Montevideo. Yo le mandé fotos para que él dibujara los techos de una parte de la ciudad vieja de la aduana para que se pareciera lo más posible. Y ahora los vio en vivo. Estuvimos hoy por ahí.
Me pregunto si les gusta mucho el fútbol.
You're asking if you like football.
What?
If you like football.
I never seen a football game.
Nunca había. Mira, en Canadá
In Canada we play hockey.
Claro. Nunca había. Nunca había un partido de fútbol, porque en Canadá no es muy popular el fútbol. Maybe in the English speaking part is more popular.
Maybe, yes.
En las partes que hablan inglés es un poquito más popular, pero en la parte donde es Philippe, lo que a nosotros es el fútbol, para ellos es el hockey sobre hielo. Con patines de hielo. Acá es imposible. Pero. ¿Tenías una pregunta tú?
Sí. ¿Es this a sketchbook?
¿Es un cuaderno donde haces dibujos ese?
No.
Pero tenía una pregunta él primero. ¿Tenías una pregunta?
Sí,
no, ok.
Yo tengo un cuaderno.
¿Tenés un cuaderno de dibujo acá? ¿Lo tenés acá?
Sí.
¿Puede traer el cuaderno para mostrarle?
Sí.
Tráelo, por favor. She has a sketchbook.
Oh, great.
¿Alguien más tiene alguna pregunta? ¿Se quiere mirar al amigo? Déjalo. Está que es mierda.
Pero...
Sí, dale.
¿Los dibujos los hizo él?
No, no, en este libro justo no los hizo él. Los hicieron dos amigos míos que son de acá, Uruguay, también. Sí, justo, Filip, anoche dimos una charla y vendió todos los libros de él que había traído. Igual los que trajo no eran como para niños, pero ha hecho cosas. You've done children's books as well.
Yeah.
Ha hecho libros para niños. Justo en esta ocasión no trajo. Y no traje ahora las revistas que hicimos ahora.
Pero... ¿Y los diálogos?
Sí, yo escribo los diálogos y también me dedico a la parte de los globitos y de poner las letras, que se llama el rotulado, que lo hago por computadora.
¿Y las partes en inglés?
¿Eh?
¿Las partes en inglés?
Ahí no hay partes en inglés. No, ese está en español.
Ese está todo en español.
De hecho, las partes en que hay personajes que hablan en idioma maya y en egipcio, porque viajan en el tiempo, están traducidas al español, porque yo no hablo ninguno de esos idiomas y creo que no hay nadie vivo que hable esos idiomas todavía.
¿Es que se refiere al crash?
Ah, vos decíslo como los ruidos.
¡Vamos!
Esos también los hago yo. Esos también los hago yo. El crash, boom, pam.
¡Catum!
Nada, es un ruido o una explosión. Hágalo, ¡catum! Es como una explosión, es como que se abre un agujero en el tiempo para que viaje. ¡Pum! ¡Pum! ¡Wush! Es como... Pasa que como leo muchas cosas en inglés y si lees muchos cómics usan ese tipo de cosas y te quedan.
Ese libro lo pueden ver en la biblioteca
Ceibal. Esta es verdad, si buscan en la biblioteca Ceibal, el nombre del libro, que es Crononautas, está ahí para que ustedes lean en su casa. Amigo.
¿Qué significa?
¿Cómo? Otro de los ruidos que puse, ya no me acuerdo, lo escribí hace un tiempo. Sí, ese ya tiene como 2 años. De... Sigue mirando.
Este libro después.
Sí.
O sea, si se puede llevar a casa.
Mira, vamos a sortear un par de libros y está acá en la biblioteca también y lo pueden pedir prestado, ¿verdad? Y lo pueden ver en la computadora. Sí, y lo pueden ver con la computadora en Ceibal. Y mirá, lo que tiene al final del libro tiene partes con textos en donde yo explico un poquito de las partes, como es un libro de viajes en el tiempo. Lo hice con la ayuda de una profesora de historia que me dijo si estaba poniendo disparates o no.
Por eso.
Al final, perdón, al final te cuenta de dónde saqué las cosas, porque a mí una de las cosas que más me provoca leer, además de me gusta, me provoca leer más. Entonces, quiero saber... ¿De dónde se inspiró el escritor para escribir? Y entre otras cosas, recomiendo los libros y las películas y las cosas que a mí me gustaban y me gustan ahora.
¿Viste que hay un libro también que da viaje del tiempo, si lo conoces? Que yo ya lo leí, que mi primo lo tenía, que yo lo leí con él.
¿Cómo se llama?
El de Rubius, el de viaje del
tiempo. No, conozco a Rubius, pero no leí el libro. Mi hijo tiene uno de los libros. Está bueno.
Entonces, también como este de viajes en el tiempo y todo eso.
Mira.
Que los que pintaron son uruguayos de otro país.
No, en ese libro somos todos uruguayos los que trabajamos, pero yo he trabajado con argentinos, he trabajado con Filip, que es de Canadá, he trabajado con gente de Suecia. En esta revista nueva que sacamos ahora, trabajé con un dibujante de Malasia.
¿Malasia?
Está muy lejos. Y que a él no lo conozco en persona, por ejemplo. Lo conocí por internet porque nos gustan las mismas cosas. He trabajado con gente de Estados Unidos también. Es lo lindo eso.
¿Dónde está?
Ahí en my wife.
¿Pero que los libros que él hace, lo hace contigo o lo hace solo?
No, ahí la mayoría dice, you do your work, your books alone or with me.
I did only one book with someone else. Well, yeah. A story. And it was his story.
Él hace todos sus libros solo, los escribe y los dibuja. Y la primera vez que dibujó una historia escrita por otra persona fue mía. Me invitó a mí a participar de un libro en Canadá. Y de hecho, era sobre una cosa que pasó en Canadá hace 21 años y que, de la cual yo sabía muy poco, porque yo tenía 15 años y no había internet exactamente igual que ahora. Y no sabía qué iba a escribir. Y lo escribí desde el punto de vista de un niño más o menos de la edad de ustedes en Uruguay que veía eso en la tele. Y Filip lo tradujo al francés y suena mucho más lindo en francés que como lo escribí yo. ¿Para qué? Cintia tiene una pregunta.
¿No era con respecto a que está inspirado a un museo?
Sí, es verdad.
¿Pueden visitar aquí?
Es verdad. Los dos protagonistas de este libro trabajan en el Museo de Historia del Arte, que está en la Intendencia, en el centro, no sé si la conocen.
Sí.
Y a mí me gusta mucho ese museo, voy desde que soy chico, y a Gabriel, mi hijo, va desde que tiene 2 años. y puede trabajar de guía de tanto que lo conoce. Entonces la primera parte del libro, no la primera, pero más o menos, se ve el museo y está dibujado directamente ahí. Y cuando presentamos el libro, lo hicimos en el museo también.
¿Cómo se sintieron cuando
su
primer
libro? How do you feel writing your first book?
The first one is the most difficult one to do.
El primer libro es el más difícil.
But afterwards, you know, once you've done one, then it comes easily. And as, the more you work, and the easier it gets to make the next books.
A medida que agarras práctica, cuantos más libros haces, más fácil se hace.
Because writing, first of all, is a work that happens in your mind. You know.
Escribir primero tiene que estar en la mente, y tienes que practicar mucho. No, sabes qué vas a escribir, you know what you're going to write. You do, sabes qué vas a escribir a veces, pero tenés que encontrar la forma de cómo lo vas a escribir y cómo lo vas a contar. Porque además, vos estás contando algo que para vos es una historia, pero te tenés que acordar que lo tiene que leer otra gente y tiene que entender. Muchas veces en el caso de los cómics puedes explicar muchas cosas con los dibujos. In comics you can explain a lot of things with the art. Pero si estás escribiendo un cuento solo con palabras, también. Y bueno, hay muchas formas de hacerlo.
And to be a good writer, you have to be a good reader.
Para ser un buen escritor hay que ser un buen lector.
Because the experience you gain as a reader, you use it back when you write.
Sí, la experiencia que ganas como lector la usas al escribir.
La conclusión de un libro no es como un nacimiento.
Finishing a book is like giving birth.
Oh yes, it's the greatest feeling on earth.
Sí, mira, yo terminé ayer la revista y fue tipo.
It's a liberation.
Es una liberación.
Este libro está basado por Uruguay, porque está acá la.
Sí, claro, es lo que te decía hoy. Los protagonistas trabajan en ese museo en la Intendencia y viajan en el tiempo, y uno de los momentos en el que viajan en el tiempo es con los 33 orientales. ¿Con cuántos años saqué mi primer libro? Ahora Felipe está dibujando y le pregunto también. Mirá, la primera historia que publiqué, la publiqué en un concurso en el liceo cuando tenía 18. Pero cuando tenía como tu edad, escribí un cuento que lo vieron mis compañeros de escuela, familia. Después, la primera cosa que publiqué, que salió y la vio gente y se vendió, tenía 29, empecé un poquito tarde. La primera revista, toda mía que saqué, tenía 31, y el primer libro tenía 32 o 33. Y Philip, el primer cómic que publicó...
En 1997,
so you were 26? Tenía 26 años cuando sacó su primera revista también. Su primera revista se llamaba Tabasco, como una salsa picante.
Tabasco,
pero con K. ¿Alguna pregunta más? Están todos mirando cómo dibuja Philip. Es realmente fascinante.
Es como que está. Parece que está calcando, pero.
No.
Era quieta y.
Mira, cuando yo conocí a Philip, estábamos en un festival de cómics y le fui a comprar un libro y le pedí que por favor me lo firmara, porque a mí me gusta mucho que los autores me firmen el libro. Philip, sí, claro, y empezó a dibujar. Y sacaba acuarelas, sacaba lápices, y me hizo un dibujo precioso. Nunca te hace un dibujito cortito, Philip siempre te hace terrible dibujo en el libro.
Decime. Tengo una pregunta. Si yo sacaría este libro.
Claro, pero él no trabajó en ese libro. Yo te lo firmo, yo sí.
¿Dónde lo firmaría?
Y mira, si lo abrís, donde está el título.
Yo te lo he firmado.
¿Eh?
Yo te lo he firmado.
No, ese lo firmó el que hizo la tapa. Pero adentro, si lo abrís, ves que ahí tiene espacio en blanco. Ahí firmamos, y si estuviera alguno de los dibujantes, que hoy no está, le hacía un dibujito. Philip, no, porque no trabajó en ese libro, y le va a dar cosas. Mira, son todos uruguayos los que trabajaron ese libro, pero el que hizo la tapa vive en Chile.
¡Victoria!
La compañera, Victoria. ¿Alguien tiene alguna pregunta más?
No.
¿No? Bueno, muchísimas gracias. Por... de eso que se encarguen las autoridades. No sé si van a sacar números o qué, pero que se encarguen las autoridades. Muchas gracias a todos.
Je crois que tu es la femme qui brûle au fond de mes yeux. Et je te vois dans le miroir d'une flamme. J'ai du talent pour toi. Toi, tu te sens rêver.
En el Eterno.
Se acaba otro programa en el que casi no hablamos. Bueno, yo sí, porque estoy en las charlas.
Y porque vos hablas más que yo siempre.
Espero que hayan disfrutado de esas charlas de Filip. Los invitamos a. En breve va a estar la GAS3K.6 para descargar. Pero si no, todavía les quedan el resto del fin de semana. Porque hoy es jueves. No, perdón, ya fue. Fue la semana pasada. Pero si no, pueden conseguir por ahí la revista, nos preguntan cómo conseguirla con las dos historias de Filip. Porque una de las cosas que no mencioné al principio del programa es que Philippe trajo algunos libros suyos para vender. Dos o tres ejemplares de cada libro que tiene en inglés y uno lo trajo en francés.
Ah, mira.
Vendió todo en la charla del Maple Leaf.
Por eso no llegamos a ver nada de la convención.
Exacto, solo estaba la revista. Bueno, y tengo los que yo poseo que me regaló a mí, ¿no? Por otro lado, quiero agradecerle a Daniel y a Rosana del Maple Leaf por habernos recibido ahí, por haber puesto versiones de prueba más baratas de los platos como el putino, las alitas, unas alitas de barbacoa que hacen, claro que son. Es un muy lindo lugar para comer, comida canadiense típica.
¿Dónde queda?
Queda en Polígona.
Ah, mira.
Y los posavasos son cooks de hockey sobre hielo que tienen en el freezer.
Bien.
Y hay alitas, hay poutine, hay Toronto Welsh, que son papas con cheddar y demás. La hamburguesa muy rica también. Y si no, tienen pizzas y empanadas y eso, pero si vas con la gente que no quiere comer cosas nuevas, ¿viste? Vas por ahí y está muy lindo y lindo ambiente. Esperamos poder tener a Philippe de vuelta por acá en algún momento o ir nosotros para allá.
Esperamos que nos inviten a ir de alguna manera.
El Consejo de las Artes de Canadá, pero bueno, y le agradecemos mucho a toda la gente que estuvo en las charlas, y a toda la gente que se acercó por el stand o a los que se llevaron tapas dibujadas por Philippe.
O de última vamos, y si nos pagan, nos pagan.
Sí, igualito que en Canadá.
Por Dios.
En el programa que viene volvemos a hablar de historietas uruguayas en otra de las entrevistas del ciclo de historietistas uruguayos, por primera vez con una dama, porque voy a estar charlando con Mako, una historietista de bajo perfil público, pero con seguidores muy rabiosos de buena manera. Hay gente que sigue muy de cerca lo que hace Mako, estaba con sus libritos pequeños en la convención y con remeras pintadas. Vamos a estar charlando con ella sobre lo que yo digo siempre, cómo empezaron a hablar de cómics, a hacer cómics, qué tal su familia, cuál fue su primer... Las mismas preguntas boludas que hago siempre, pero como el autor es distinto, las respuestas son diferentes. ¿Algo más que quieras contar, Andreu?
No, en realidad digo, yo ya me tengo que ir.
¿Ya te tenés que ir? Bueno, yo me tengo que ir a darle de comer acá al profesor que está al lado y a cenar yo. Un saludo para toda la audiencia, un saludo para mi hija, ahora que te vas para tu casa, para Irina, para la mamá, por supuesto. Y nos estamos escuchando la semana que viene en Perdidos en el Éter, porque ser extraño tiene su ciencia.
Hasta luego.
Atención, la conexión interdimensional se encuentra inestable. Esta transmisión puede, en cualquier momento,